Mastering meditation. Mastering meditation is just doing it. That's all you need to do. And you need to do it reasonably regularly. There's an ideal of meditating every day. It really helps some people. So of the regular students that I've been teaching here in Bromley for 5 years, and I started at St Mark's Church in Bromley South, and there's still got a handful of students who still come along from then. So they've been meditating at least 5 years, and some of my students have been meditating for a long time before then. And what that happens is that they discover that their day changes completely if they meditate in the morning. They have a good day. If they don't, they have a bad day. And it changes their experience of life. That's one of the many, many reasons to meditate. It's important to explain what meditation is. You'll hear a lot of, or read a lot of information about meditation. Most of it is completely uninformed. Whenever I do pick up an article, I haven't actually bought a newspaper for 5 years now, and I haven't watched a night's television since 1997. But you can't get away from the news, for example. So I got a taxi down today for one reason or another, and the guy decided to, so there's all about Parliament and Brexit and stuff like that. So it's impossible not to know what's going on. But that, putting that to one side, from time to time students say, oh look, here's an article about meditation, so I'll go and look it up online. And generally speaking, it's totally uninformed. So I would take no notice of anything in the media at all, ever. If I encountered a journalist that knew about meditation, then I'd recommend them. Similarly with books, as I developed my practice and got more into teaching, I wanted to learn more and more, and so I'd buy books on meditation. Yeah. And they're all for the bin, except for one, possibly two. I'm reading the second one now. The one to buy is a book called The Restful Mind, and it's fantastic. I have never had, you recommend books to people. You say, oh, you should get this book. And when people are honest, some of them will say, yeah, it's great. Some of them will say, oh, it's bunk. I've not had anybody say anything other than it's great. And it's written by a Buddhist monk, so that if you want information on meditation, that's where to get it. So let me clarify what meditation is. Meditation is any practice where we're observing our inner experience. Now, if all the meditations that you could do are the size of this room, the meditations I teach are the size of my fist. It's a tiny subset of what people call meditation. And there are a lot of things that people call meditation that aren't really meditation, but there you go, you see, this is all part of the, there isn't a definition for it, and people jump on a bandwagon and all of that kind of stuff. So the meditations that I teach fall into two categories, really. I do the occasional other meditation, or teach the occasional other meditation as well. But they're either mindfulness or gratitude practices. So the thing to remember about the gratitude practices, they aren't actually necessarily about gratitude. They're about focusing on our more comfortable, more enjoyable inner experiences. And if we develop these practices, we can learn to elevate our mood at will, which is a very useful thing in these days. Among other things, I teach courses. On the courses, one out of every 10 people tell me my life has changed because I am doing these practices. So it, more than anything else, it's a change of perspective. So that's the gratitude side. I won't be covering that today. Today I'll be covering the mindfulness meditations. And mindfulness is the undistracted awareness of the experience of the present moment. It isn't an absence of thought, because thought is part of the present moment. Here's all the misconceptions. Actually, probably the primary misconception is that meditation and mindfulness are the same thing. Mindfulness is an experience we have in our day. Meditation is the training. It's how we train ourselves to learn mindfulness. Mindfulness is the undistracted awareness of the present moment. So if I'm thinking, one of two things can be happening. Either I'm so deeply absorbed by my thought that I'm not aware of my surroundings, which is what we call mind wandering, and we have very reliable data from a brilliant study which tells us that in the modern world we spend 50% of our lives with our mind wandering, and some of us obviously a lot more, because the average person's probably working or they're looking after a family or whatever it might happen to be, and so they're spending a lot of time doing things and they're thinking about what they're doing and focusing on it. That's not mind wandering. Mind wandering is when you're absorbed in an experience. So mindfulness is being aware of your experience rather than being absorbed by it. And you're aware of your inner experience, thoughts and emotions, as well as your external experience, sense perceptions, and what you can see, hear, smell, touch and taste, balance, where you are in the room, how cool or warm you are, how tired or alert you are, how relaxed or tense you are. When you look at it, there are actually an awful lot of senses, and we don't think about most of them. But when we're plugged into our present moment and we're aware of the sounds, the smells, the tastes, or even just one part of that, that's mindfulness. As long as we're allowing that experience into our present moment. And so the problem is that this mind wandering is quite a compelling thing, right? Every so often I meet somebody who says, my entire life I've been able to focus my mind away from unhelpful thoughts and uncomfortable emotions. And now that X has happened, where X is some adversity, and that can be retiring, that can be children moving away, that can be, illness, injury, disability to yourself or your loved ones or whatever. It can be changing jobs. It can be something like that. What's happened is that the mind started to wander, and it tends to wander to unhelpful places. So let me use a newspaper analogy, as I mentioned it a little bit earlier. One of my hobbies is reading the headlines for newspapers. And you go, say, into a petrol station, and just before you go into the petrol station, they've got this big square plastic trolley with Perspex windows on it, and in it is the newspapers, and you can see all the headlines. And they're all competing for the most shocking headline. Because the reason is the psychology of it. It will get your attention. Whatever's the most shocking headline will get your attention. So Daily Mail wins this competition almost invariably. And what that is that displays an element of human experience known as negativity bias. Two big messes in the human mind, the modern mind. I might cover biases in my next series, the Modern Mind series. Bias number one is confirmation bias, which is that every new thing is interpreted so that it confirms what you already believe. And if you actually waste your time listening to politicians, that's what you see. So you get two politicians, there'll be an event. Politicians will say, this confirms what we believe, and then politician B will say, this confirms what we believe. And this is what we all do. So confirmation bias is part of being human, but also negativity bias. With threats always trump rewards. for our attention. They have to, because it's a survival trait. We're the children of many, 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 many generations going back 2 billion years to the first life on Earth, where our ancestors have been alert for the presence of a threat and have managed to avoid it and survive. So whenever we perceive a threat, that's where our attention will go. Similarly, if we're in our mind, if we perceive a threat, that's where the mind's attention goes. Not all the time, but pretty consistently. So the information from this study proves that beyond doubt. And actually, so does anecdotes. You know, you chat to people, and I'm in a privileged position to speak to people about the contents of their mind. And it's not uncommon for somebody to find this situation where they're dwelling unhelpfully on unhelpful thoughts. Now, our culture doesn't really explain the mind. It doesn't even begin to explain the mind. You've got thoughts, you've got emotions. And so if you look up thought in psychology textbooks and you're looking for a definition of thought, they'll come up with something like, oh, it's a cognitive process. So if you go and look up cognitive process, they'll say, oh, it's thought. Yeah. Because thought is subjective, you can't see somebody else's thoughts, you can't measure it. So subsequently, psychology hasn't really bothered with thoughts, although there's one specific researcher called Hurlburt who put buzzers on people and it buzzed randomly during the day, and then they would write down their inner experience. And we can see from that something that I'd learned anyway, which is some people have a repetitive inner dialogue. It's a voice. It's my voice, generally. Or that could be somebody else's voice. It's very normal for many of us to have many, many voices. So having, you know, if you imagine you're remembering a discussion you had with half a dozen people yesterday, well, there's 7 voices. And if you're commenting on it internally, that's 8, right? So don't worry about that. That's fine. Hearing voices is only a problem if you believe them to be actual, real, living entities in this moment, which is a unfortunate mental disorder. But, you know, having voices in your head is a very common thing. But if you look at the results from Hurlburt's studies and what I've learned, is there are some people, constant chatter, and there are other people, there isn't really much chatter. Thoughts tend to consist of, or any chatter, thoughts then tend to consist of images and a sense of something. So, you know, think of a person's name, right? Say their name in your head. So for those of you that can, you'll say their name in their head. Now, think of that person without saying their name in your head. So that's the other end of the scale. And so everybody's somewhere between this. So the thing that intervenes the most in the present moment is our own mind. And the way it intervenes is through mind wandering, and it tends to mind wander to unhappy places. So then what's happened is this, is when meditation teachers teach, they've probably fallen into this same trap themselves of trying to silence the mind and wanting the mind to be calm and still and clear like a mountain pool. And they're then judging and comparing each experience with, is my mind calm and clear and still like a mountain pool, or isn't it? And if it isn't, then it's unsatisfactory. And the main reason people stop meditating is because when they sit quietly, they notice the inner voice more than before they'd started meditating, and actually give up. Wherever I go, I ask for shows of hands on these things in big groups and organisations. And something like 50% of the people that I encounter have tried meditation. And of that group, only 5% have a regular practice. So you're probably talking about 2% of the population now meditates regularly. Half of us have tried and we can't keep it up. And it's because of the way it's been taught. So now I teach it in a completely different way. I make it a lot more accessible. And to begin to do that, what I'll do is I'll explain the practice. So there isn't much that you actually have to do this practice. But it's useful if you put your feet flat on the floor, because that changes your relationship to your environment completely, actually. Changes everything, just putting your feet on the floor. And it's a listening exercise. I'll begin with a listening exercise. And the listening exercise is a very specific sort of listening exercise. So as we're going to listen, you don't have to close your eyes. You can half close your eyelids and look down past the tip of your nose at the floor, just so that you don't get distracted by anything that's going on around you. Or alternatively, you can close your eyes. And what we're listening for is the next sound. See, the modern mind finds a sound and sticks to that sound for a while, maybe a long time. And then it moves its attention to another sound and stays focused on that sound, and it tunes everything else out. But the ancient mind, which is what you'll be using in a moment, it's listening for the next sound. And so as we sit here, there's airplanes, there's movements in the building, there's movements in the room, there's some sort of work going on somewhere, so there's a bit of hammering happening. There's the sound of birds, there's rain. And the thing to do is, rather than finding a nice noise and listening to the nice noise, become like a sentinel, like your awareness is all around you for sound. You want to know what the next sound is and where it's coming from. It could be in front of you, behind you, to either side above you. And then, of course, there's the sound of my voice. So this isn't a meditation, so there's no right or wrong way of doing it, so you can't get it wrong. And there's no instructions. So if the mind's busy, the mind's busy. If the mind wanders, the mind wanders. None of that matters. But it's just listening for the next sound. And noticing that that sound can happen anywhere. So to help you, it might be better if you imagine that the room is dark. So here you are, you're in a dark room. You're in a dark, unfamiliar room and you're alone. So you're listening to every sound. Just waiting for the sound. So we're not focusing on sound, we're just waiting for the next sound to happen. or indifferent to our inner experience, whatever emotions there are, whatever thoughts there are, however comfortable or uncomfortable, we're not interested. Just listening, just waiting for the next sound, wherever it might be, and whatever it might be. Just listening, just waiting from time to time. You might notice your mind wander, or you might notice that you're focusing on a sound or whatever. It doesn't matter. Just listening for the next sound. One thing you'll notice from all of this sound, it's a bit like a hubbub. You know, if you walk into a room and lots of people are talking and you can't hear anybody's conversation, all you hear is the voices, that's a hubbub. In the present moment, in a sound-rich environment, there's a hubbub. And you're noticing time moving. So sound arises and you're waiting for the next one. Sound arises, waiting for the next one. Sound arises. You're noticing the movement of time. Help you notice the movement of time just by ringing this bell. Notice the bell moving through time. And so you were probably focusing on the bell. Now listen for the next sound. Listen all around you for the next sound while the bell is just happening in the background. So this listening, waiting for the next sound, something you can do anywhere. Now, as well as all of the other sounds, there's the sound of my voice. And if you listen for the next sound instead of listening to what I'm saying, ignore what I'm saying. Just listen all around you for the next sound. And then what I'm saying just becomes part of the hubbub. It becomes just another sound. And in this, you're also aware of your thoughts. You're listening for the next sound. My words are arising. You're listening for the next word. It's all a hubbub. And the thoughts, they're part of that hubbub too. And you can listen for the next thought. Doesn't matter what thought it is, there's a next one. You're waiting for another thought. When a thought comes, it'll play out. You might notice it and wait for the next thought. Just waiting for the next thought, waiting for the next word, waiting for the next sound. All the same thing. And in the same way, we're indifferent to the sounds. You're also indifferent to what I'm saying. Because all my words are, they're like thoughts that I'm speaking. And then there's your thoughts, and you're indifferent to the thoughts. Just noticing them rising and subsiding, waiting for the next thought, waiting for the next word, waiting for the next sound, and it's all just the hubbub of the present moment. And so there's a thing that you can do with my words, is to wait for the next wait for the next word. And do the same thing with thoughts. You can say in your mind, wait for the next thought. Try it. And then come back to wait for the next sound. Wait for the next word. Listen for the sound. Listen for the word. Listen for the thoughts. Wait for the next thought. And notice the hubbub. Okay. So in your very own time, gently return your attention to the room. So what that does, for 95% of people, the first part of it, where we're waiting for the next sound, listening for the next sound, is a frictionless experience. And it's something that you can do anywhere. So for instance, notice that you could do it while I was speaking. You could be doing it now. Or I can be doing it now. So I'm speaking and I'm listening for the next sound. The reason we can do that is because it's always happening. You get up in the morning, it's time you go to bed, your brain is listening for the next sound. That's how, if something happens around you, although you might be focused on something else, if something happens around you and it's a potential threat, you become alerted to it. You become aware of it. So your brain is processing constantly new sounds, matching them with its memory of sound. If it finds one that it sees to be, or it matches it against what it sees to be a threat, it alerts you to it. You look round. You already know what you're looking round at. So this is happening all the time. And all we're doing here is we're plugging into that. Then the experience of listening to my words, for most people, when I extend them like that, the mind becomes silent, waiting for the next word. And then, of course, you've got your own thoughts. And, you know, you might be at the constant chatter end, or you might be at the visual end. For those of us that can construct an inner voice in our mind, we can notice the same experience when we do that ourselves. So when we say in our mind, wait for the next thought, there's a silence. And we may never have noticed silence over many decades. And that's where it can come from. If our mind is, and thoughts rather, if our thoughts are images, we can wait for the next image. We notice there's a lag between one and the other. So what we're seeing there, underneath all of this quite busy experience of being human, is that there's a still, calm silence in there. But at first we only get a little snippet of it. So now two things need to happen to be able to connect to this experience. The calmness, the stillness of the present moment. One is that you need to meditate in a way that enables you to notice your inner experience, so listening for your thoughts, or watching for your thoughts, waiting for thoughts. To do that, you need to be in a pretty good place, because obviously if the mind's going 10 to the dozen, it doesn't work. So here's one of the misconceptions of meditation. So meditation and similar sort of thing for mindfulness, but for meditation. So meditation is a stress management thing, so therefore when you're stressed, you meditate. Wrong. You meditate when you're not stressed. It's the training. Yeah. So if I'm a tennis player and I'm going to go out on the court in Wimbledon, I don't go into the gym in the morning. Right. What I actually want is to train when my body has recovered so that I can get the benefit of the training. You get it deeply in your head. The meditation is the training. It's the training for the experience of mindfulness. And to make the experience of mindfulness as useful as possible for you, as comfortable as possible for you, look for the silence, look for the stillness, look for the calmness, and do it when you're feeling good. So then to get there, actually get to, you know, people wake up in the morning and they're on autopilot the entire day. Nothing will break into their autopilot. Thoughts, thoughts, thoughts. The body drives to work. The body does the job. You might come home in the evening and look around you and think, well, actually, this is the first time I've been aware today. All the rest of it, I've just done it, you know, as an example. You don't have to necessarily have a job for that. You just have to live in what I call the modern mind. And the modern mind is a mind of autopilot, where you're just acting out one behaviour, acting out another behaviour, acting out another behaviour. Then very, very rarely you sit down and think about this and ask yourself whether it's what you really want to do. And you think, I've got no choice, so you go back to doing it. Acting out, behaviour, behaviour, behaviour. And that's it, and then it's all over. So what we want to be able to do is to choose what our mind does as often as possible. And to choose, we need to be here. We need to be present in the present moment. So to get back to the present moment from the mind wandering, we need to train ourselves to do it. And that's the key mindfulness meditation. So what I'll do is I'll teach you this mindfulness meditation the easy way. And the easy way is to get as comfortable as you like and put your elbows by your side. Comfort first, then all of the posture that I'm going to teach you. Feet on the floor, elbows by the side, and your head comfortably on top of your spine. Just find the point at which it's most comfortably balanced on top of your spine. There's the head, there's the elbows, there's the feet. And what we're going to do is notice a movement. And the movement, in the same way that listening to the next sound is always there, but you've never really noticed it, probably. The movement's always there, but you've never really noticed it, probably. We don't notice these things because we live in the modern world. We lead modern lives, living in the modern world, and we're in the modern mind. I mean, just things we just don't notice because of that. And what this is the movement of the belly. Just at the point where the belly meets the chest. And it's there all the time. Rising and falling. And you may need to put your fingers there to notice it, you may not. It doesn't matter. I tend to prefer to do that. Sometimes I do, sometimes I don't. I think overall I've got a preference for just putting my hand on top of the belly and noticing it. You notice the belly rising and noticing the belly falling. And that's it. So there's no further instructions. Just noticing that tiny little movement. Belly rising, belly falling. If you have a particularly busy mind, it might help if you label the movement of the belly. You're noting it. And to note it, what you do is you say in your mind, when the belly's rising, when the belly's rising, you say in your mind, rising. And when the belly's falling, you say in your mind, falling. Rising, falling. And yet again, there's no instruction, so there's no way of doing this wrong. You can't get it wrong. And this is what I call the meditation of no meditation for the breath. and the beginning of the previous practice where we're noticing sound, waiting for the next sound, I call that the meditation of no meditation for sound. That's all you're doing, noticing that tiny movement. Now what we're going to do is move into a fully fledged mindfulness meditation. This is how we train our mind to come back to the present moment during the day. Breathing in and out through the nostrils. Almost the same as noticing the movement in the belly. Except now we're noticing the nostrils. If that's comfortable for you, if it's uncomfortable for you, you just go back to the belly. But I'll teach it as if we're doing the nostrils. And if you place your tongue gently up against the back of your top teeth, you notice that you naturally breathe in and out through the nostrils. And the same thing, you're noticing the breath rising, noticing the breath falling. You say in your mind, rising on the in-breath, falling on the out-breath. Rising, falling. And if your mind wanders, when you notice that your mind's wandered, you gently return your attention to the breath. That's it, just noticing the breath rising and falling. You could be saying rising and falling in your mind if you wish, or not, doesn't matter. When you notice that your mind's wandered, come back and notice the breath. So this is 2,600 years old at least. Begin and end the meditation with a bell. This is called following the breath. We'll just practice it for the next few minutes. Okay, so breathing in, noticing whatever it is you can smell, what you can taste. And in your very, very, very own time, gently return your attention to the room. Okay, so what you will have noticed there is the mind wandering. Okay? And at some point, you'll notice your mind's wandering and you come back and you're noticing the breath. Mind wandering, breath. Mind wandering breath. The modern mind really unhelpfully decides, because of its past experience, that this is a competition to stay noticing the breath. Because like everything else in life's a competition, right? So this must be too. So you think, that's a competition, I need to stay focused on the breath, I'm noticing the breath, and either my mind's really busy or my mind just keeps wandering. And so therefore, I'm no good at meditation. It's rubbish. Maybe it's just not for me. And some of you may well have been thinking this while we were doing it. If you're new to it, quite probably. But the magic happens when you notice that your mind's wandered. Let me give you some examples. So drivers, who drives in the group? Yeah. Okay, for those of you who don't drive, trust me about this. You get in your car and you're driving along, and then you look around you and you think, oh, going the wrong way. It happens less with sat navs now, but you know, back in the days when there were no sat navs, it would be very common. You might end up driving quite a long way. You're actually driving the wrong way. Here's another experience that we're all aware of, which is one of my favourite mind wandering explanations. There you are. Why am I at the fridge? You're at the fridge. You've opened the fridge. You don't know what you want. You don't know why you're there. You know, just wandered in from another room. You're looking in the fridge. Or you wander from one room to another. You get to the other room and you've forgotten why you're there. So you go back to the first room, right? Or you're reading a magazine or a book or something like that. You're narrating it in your head. You're narrating all the words, they're getting read. Get to the bottom of the page and you realise that your mind was wandering, so you have to go back. So those are all examples of like the aha moment that you recognise that your mind's wandered and you remember that you're here. It's like, remember, oh, here I am. Oh, I should be driving the other way. You know, oh, what am I doing in this room? Let's go back. Aha, 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 aha. When we do the following the breath meditation, what we want to do is to repeat that as many times as we can. Because what we're doing is repeating the experience of noticing that our mind has wandered and then bringing our attention back to now. And if you do it enough, let's say you do 15, 20 minutes of that meditation every day, just say you were to do that. Most people don't for a whole load of reasons. So many of them nothing to do with meditation, to do with just the life is going at 1,000 miles an hour. And you do 15 minutes a day, every day. What will happen is that you start going around your day and you'll have that experience more. Because everything that you repeat often in the brain does that thing. This is why you can drive. This is why you can walk. This is why you can do all of the things you do. You've learned through repetition. Yeah? One foot in front of the other when you're a toddler. Oh dear, bump. Back up again, one foot in front of the other. Just keep going, keep going, keep going, keep going. Learning to juggle. Catch, catch, catch. Over and over and over again. Learning to come back to the present moment. Mind wanders, notice, back to the present moment. Mind wanders, notice, back to the present moment. Over and over again. So that is how we train ourselves to become present. And then when we're here, a good way to be here, because we don't know what it's like, it's an innate capacity to be present that we all have, but because of the modern life and the modern world, it's just like act out one behaviour, act out another behaviour, act out another behaviour. That's the end of that day. And repeat Groundhog Day over and over and over again. And then go on holiday and act out, you know, pool beach, various excursions, wander around a museum, pool beach, various excursions. Sorry. Mountains, ski, ski, bar, ski, ski, bar, ski, ski, bar. I'm not knocking it. I think travel's a wonderful thing, but that you're just doing, you just find that you're doing the same things in various different places. Even if you're a solo traveller, walk, bus, ask, map, walk, bus, ask, map, sleep in a flea pit, meet some people, get drunk, walk, ask, bus, map. It doesn't matter where you are, what you're doing, it's the same thing. So behaviour, behaviour, behaviour. And you know, the traveller in the exotic land, the reason, and especially when you're on holiday as well, the reason that you enjoy it more is because you're here more. But you're not here more for any other reason than it's all novel. And when it's novel, you become more aware because there's potential for danger. And so if you're somewhere where there's a real potential for danger, you're climbing the north face of the Eiger, you are totally connected to the present moment. But you don't have to climb the north face of the Eiger to be connected to the present moment. All you need to do is repeat the following the breath meditation every day. But most of us aren't going to do that for a whole bundle of reasons. So if life's going at 1,000 miles an hour, fitting in 15 minutes a day of noticing the breath, which just becomes a kind of mind-wandering exercise, and remember, mind wanders to unhelpful places generally, it lacks a certain something that we expect in the modern world. So to make it easier for you, I have constructed a number of rules, and there is also a purpose that I've adopted from a great meditation teacher. The purpose of meditation is to become familiar with your mind. Familiar with it. It's like a new neighbour. You want to become familiar with them so that when there's a problem, you know how to deal with them. Same with the mind. You want to become familiar with it. So when there's a problem, if it goes off on one, you've got a strategy of some sort. You can intervene in the unhelpfulness of your own mind, which can be really unhelpful. In fact, it is, in the modern world, the most unhelpful thing in our lives is our own mind. And so we do all sorts of things to numb it. You know, distraction, escapism, comfort and pleasure. If you lose somebody you love now, people pop up and tell you to do something to keep yourself busy, distract yourself. It's because we're not comfortable with the mind. It's not something we want to deal with. And it seems to have a mind of its own, right? You know, you want to get asleep and it wants to stay up. That's it. You know, or you don't want to think about certain thing and your mind's going there all the time. Or you want to remember something and it just refuses to remember stuff. Yeah. But you can remember other stuff that you don't care about. The stuff you care about, it won't remember that. And so this is what the mind's like. You need to become familiar with it and understand the currents. The way I describe it, it's like an ocean. And there are currents in it. And there are currents that move towards stress and anxiety, fear, worry, anger, resentment, etc., etc. And there are currents that move towards calmness. And to get there is not a long way. It takes a single moment. Listen to the bell. Notice how calm the mind becomes. Notice how you're in the present moment. Notice how the modern world's dispensed with bells. Notice why we had them. Wake up in the morning on a Sunday. Ding, 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 ding. What a wonderful way to wake up. listening to the sound of the bell. Instead, we've got to do this, go there, see this thing, see this person. Oh, there's a message. So what we want to be able to do, two things. One, get back to now. And when we get back to now, we want to listen to the silence between the thoughts. And the mind is going to do its thing in the background. And we can dip into this. We can do it for 10 seconds. We can do it for 30 seconds. You can take a look at your mind. What am I doing? Here's a little exercise. Notice the tension in your shoulders. Breathe in, breathe out, let it go. Just do that for the mind. And the way to do it is listen for the next sound. Wherever you are, whatever you're doing, you just come back to it. You're checking in with your mind. But you don't check in with your mind by like, what am I thinking? Because there's a thought. Instead, you listen to the next sound. Listen to the next sound and what thoughts there they are in the background. And I understand for some of us that the thoughts, they can be really compelling, they can be really unhelpful, and it can be really rubbish. But I believe absolutely that if you can find a practice, get it into your life, do it in a way that's frictionless, like the meditation of no meditation for sound, the meditation of no meditation for the breath. Do it at a time when you're not under pressure, because some days you're under more pressure than others, some weeks you're under more pressure than others, some months you're under more pressure. Find the time when you have a little bit less of that stress and pressure. That's when to meditate. Fix our roof in the sunshine. You're in control, so you get to choose. You choose what meditation you do when, how long you do it for. Baby steps, start with the stuff that works for you, that's nice and easy. Don't grind out 20 minutes of following the breath if you're hating every single moment of it. It will come in time. Instead, listen for the next sound. You're in control, baby steps. Fix your roof in the sunshine and do less than you can. So if you can do 15 minutes of following the breath, do 13. If you can do 10 minutes, do 8. If you can do 20 minutes, do 15. And that way there's never a problem, and don't expect anything from it. Whatever you expect, this is the mind, like, I expect to get to sleep tonight because I get to get up early in the morning, right? That's the sort of... You expect something from meditation, you won't find it. You're just doing this to become familiar with the mind. And that you notice that if something's scarily unfamiliar, the more you get to spend time with it, noticing it, in a way that's not uncomfortable for you, the more comfortable you get with it. So find the times where you're comfortable with your mind and meditate then, rather than the other way around. Meditating to make it comfortable. It's just time you're spending with your mind, getting to know it. Okay, that's mastering meditation in an hour.